Of all the characters in American cinema, there is perhaps none cooler than Ferris from Ferris Bueller's Day Off. He is idolized by many. He's suave and, by and large, carefree. As Cameron explains,
you know, as long as I've known him, everything works for him. There's nothing he can't handle. I can't handle anything.
Ferris Bueller is a mythic ideal, so much so that it has inspired fans to concoct theories about Ferris being a figment of Cameron's imagination. Don't worry, I promise that's not the focus of this video. Even without subscribing to these wild fan theories, I always thought of Ferris as a representation of a perfect, too-good-to-be-true lifestyle that we can only imagine. Until more recently, when I came to recognize the movie in a different light. We spend the entirety of Ferris Bueller's Day Off watching spoiled, wealthy children elude and have fun at the expense of working-class individuals. In Marxist terms, members of the bourgeoisie play while the proletariat is left behind to not only idolize them, but, in the case of Mr. Rooney, chase after them. Ferris, Cameron, and Sloane epitomize the bourgeoisie, down to their activities of museum going and fine dining. Imagine putting a price tag on this day off, complete with a trip to the city and a baseball game. The movie even gives us a visual representation of these characters' upper-class status, as they look down on Chicago from the top of the Sears Tower. From this vantage point, Sloane observes,
"The city looks so peaceful from up here."
Underlying Sloane's description of how peaceful the city looks is a reminder that these characters have the means to choose to separate themselves from the city below. As Ferris concisely puts it,
"Anything is peaceful from 1,353 feet."
Even when they aren't on their day off, these characters enjoy a distinctly bourgeois lifestyle. Consider the many luxurious gadgets and toys that Ferris has been spoiled with by his parents. Applying Marx's concept of use value, which refers to the utility of a given commodity, we see that Ferris has little use for all that he owns. For example, he owns a clarinet that he can't even play.
Never had one lesson.
Here, Ferris exemplifies the bourgeois practice of accruing commodities without regard for use value. Ferris's parents have exchanged the fulfillment of utility and purpose in the futile search for fulfillment from ownership and consumption. While looking at Ferris Bueller's Day Off through this Marxist lens does illuminate the class tensions that exist in the film, I do not mean to suggest that John Hughes set out to create a film that takes a hard look at class conflict. But taking into account the context of the film's release, Ferris Bueller's Day Off does reflect a distinctly 1980s American understanding of class relations in the era of Reaganomics. In the wake of a recession, the rich were climbing further and further away from the rest of society, while the working class remained stagnant in regard to their wages and savings. A recent study published in the London School of Economics and Political Sciences International Inequalities Institute found that over the past 50 years in 18 countries, including the United States, tax cuts for the rich have not stimulated the economy or promoted job growth, but have in fact increased income inequality. This is all contrary to Reagan's infamous trickle-down theory of economics, which proposed that these tax cuts would generate more wealth for everyone.
Our aim is to increase our national wealth so all will have more, not just redistribute what we already have, which is just a sharing of scarcity.
The trickle-down theory falls apart when the wealthiest members of society hoard their wealth rather than injecting it back into the economy. Cameron's father, who we never actually see, epitomizes this type of wealth hoarder.
Ferris, my father loves this car more than life itself.
Man with priorities so far out of whack doesn't deserve such a fine automobile.
Similar to Ferris's possessions that lack use value, Cameron's father does not use this car. Ferris is the one who convinces Cameron to take this car for a ride. And what happens as soon as they take it into the city? They leave it in a garage where two of the attendants, evidently members of the lower working class, take the car for a joyride. If we view the Ferrari as a representation of capital, this has serious connotations in a movie set against the backdrop of Reagan-era trickle-down economic theory. As soon as the bourgeoisie ceases their hoarding of capital, in this case embodied by the Ferrari, the proletariat enjoys it at their expense. Significantly, the joyride scene is accompanied by the score from Star Wars. This resonates with the fact that these proletariat workers are entering a new galaxy, or lifestyle, that is foreign to them. Also significant is that the garage attendants, on their day off, choose to leave the city of Chicago to drive in a more rural area. A complete reversal of the bourgeois teenagers who take a day off from suburbia to spend a day in the city. Ultimately, Ferris Bueller's day off does illustrate that more joy can be derived from the destruction of your capital than the mindless saving of it. Of course, we cannot ignore the generational conflict that exists alongside the class conflict in this movie. Cameron destroys his father's car in a defiant statement to stand up to his father. The movie then is hopeful that these young people, for all their recklessness, apathy, and naivete, these high schoolers will be the ones to break the cycle established by their parents through their ability to recognize what makes life worth living.
Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
Overly optimistic? Sure, but come on, it's a comedy.
Dark shame, darling, dark shame. Thank you for all the joy and